Hello, and thank you all for joining us today with Otometrics. And we're having a webinar today about how to prioritize the vestibular tests based on the patient history. Our presenter today is Dr. Nicolas Perez. He is at the Clínica Universitaria de Navarra, and he is a clinical consultant of the Department of Otolaryngology and a full professor of otolaryngology. Today, I'm your moderator. My name is Maggie Borzanis, and I'm the Balance Product Manager at Otometrics. Before we get started, we just want to go through a few tips and tricks. We're going to ask that all participants mute their own microphone to reduce any background noise. It's definitely possible to ask any questions during the sessions using the question box in your webinar menu bar. The questions are going to be collected during this session and will be answered at the end of the session. If we don't get to all of the questions, we'll send replies after the webinar. If you experience any technical problems or need any support, we're going to ask that you please write a message directly to me, the moderator. All right, so without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and give Dr. Perez control of the presentation. Here we go.
Okay, thank you very much, Magdalena, and of course also my thanks to Mariana that is probably flying around the world, and of course people from Otometrics here in Spain, there in Denmark, there in the US, also NATUS, whoever all you are, thank you very much for this opportunity to make this presentation. Of course, it's a everything around teaching is great for all us, and in particular, anything on vestibular is great. So without leaving more time, I want to stress before going to what I want to talk, some very important remarks when we are seeing patients with dizziness. So, and the first one is this very simple, very probably stupid for many of you, but just knowing which is the main problem of the patient is the main task of clinical history taking. And probably my recommendation is always just to have a clear view of what the patient has. Is he or she coming because of a vertigo or because of a chronic imbalance or dizziness? The second point, I want to stress is that we may be very clear in this. You know, for many years, a lot of people used to say the most important thing is clinical history taking when you are seeing vertigo or patient with any kind of vertigo or dizziness, whatever. And of course, this is true, but probably it is very much, it's also as important to perform a good vestibular bedside testing or have a good vestibular laboratory testing results, because many times your results at the vestibular bedside or laboratory tests are going to implement the history taking. Probably they will help you to see something that you did not ask for. So do not put both issues well separated one of the other. One is going to have implications in the other, and the other as well in the first one. Which is the overview for an approach, history, bedside examination, testing of reflexes, vestibulo-ocular and vestibulo-spinal, as we can now. And then you can go for dynamic vestibular function. But this is the approach of how I will recommend seeing these patients. There's a big part that is going to help you a lot in the history and the bedside as well, the lab testing of the VOR and the vestibulospinal reflex, but afterwards we have to know how these reflexes are used or are implemented by the patient in the daily living. So we have several tests as dynamic posturography, dynamic visual acuity that are going to help us. So third point, seven signs you can never miss. And this is for 100% of patients with vertigo or dizziness. We have to have a record of all these 7 points, the saccades and smooth pulse, that means how extraocular works, spontaneous nystagmus with or without fixation, gaze evoked nystagmus, a part of the other one, ocular misalignment with the alternate cover test, head impulse, post-head CA nystagmus, and positional nystagmus. Probably the four more important are these, this is something that no patient with dizziness, I would say, or no patient in which we are going to do something in the inner ear mustn't have. Then we have the fourth point, the probably it's hard to say, is this bedside, is this laboratory testing for me? It's very difficult to separate because since the very beginning, I have used the video head impulse test as part of my daily office work. I mean, I have my video head impulse test close to me, and I think I get much more information once I finish history taking and bedside examination. I perform this test. I rely on my work, I rely on my collaborators, but I like to do them. I like to go ahead in the testing, just giving for me some answers that I am making just after the clinical history taken and bedside examination. So when I have a patient with vertigo, I have just first two questions. One, is this the first and only vertigo spell, or has the patient suffered many other spells? In the first case, we are probably at the emergency room, of course, as you may know, and we have to do mainly two things. Search for triggers. Probably many of the patients are going to be diagnosed soon in this case because there was a head trauma, barotrauma, whiplash, some drugs, some given by any other doctor, and this is gonna induce some vestibular damage. Sometimes we do not find any trigger, and we are probably facing what we should say more common in the neurotology work, the acute unilateral vestibulopathy or a vestibular neuritis. When we have open at this point the whole bunch of differential diagnosis of brainstem ictus or probably some metabolic disease. Some other times we have a patient that has suffered many other spells, and there we come with three simple questions. Do you consider about any provoking disorder? So we have probably facing the most frequent, the positional provoking symptoms, that is the VPPV. But of course, we can have some VPPV from a central disorder providing or making the patient to suffer a positional vertigo. So examination is very important. Superior canal dehiscence is going to have a very important provocative, like it is sound or pressure in the ear. Sometimes we don't, and the patient is telling us, no, there's no provoking. The dizziness, the vertigo spells come as they want. So we have to ask, do you have some hearing loss? And then we are probably facing many years disease, but many patients do not have hearing loss. So the next question is, do you have some migraines? And then we are facing now the vestibular migraine, the vestibular paroxysmia. In case there's no migraine, sometimes there could be some migraine, but mainly patients without migraine, we're having several interesting problems like syncopes, panic attacks, of course, transient ischemic attacks, or hypoglycemia. So this is the roadmap for working with patients with vertigo. From I used to say that each of them is a box where I put the patient and I have to make the differential diagnosis. That probably is a little bit more than this one. So going from clinical history, we go to bedside examination. That is going to be a little bit different if the patient has any provocative positional symptom or not. And then I go to the video head impulse test. Why? Because most frequently acute peripheral vestibulopathy or unilateral vestibulopathy will be manifest by low gain of the VR and of course the resection saccades. And this is the typical patient that comes to the emergency room, but sometimes after many years it shows up at the clinic and okay, I had a vertigo spell many years ago and now I have chronic dizziness. And then this is the picture you have. As you may see, this is the video head impulse test. All canals on your on the left side of the screen is the left impulses directed to the left side, and on the right side to the right labyrinth we have the superior canal or anterior canal, then the horizontal and the posterior. And of course it's so simple that we see now here how the eye velocity does not match the head velocity in the case of the left anterior and the left lateral canals. The others are doing well. So this is a disorder, a lesion in the vestibular nerve, in the superior division of the left vestibular nerve, so we have a localization. And in the acute case, will give us some prognosis. So this is the point where I would like to stress that we have to look for. Which are the main signs we do see here? First, the low gain of the VOR for head impulses in the superior and the horizontal canal. You see that is 0.26, 0.06 on gain, and this should be one. And this is very simply shown in the video. Of course, we have to in the recording, we have to look to the numbers. And then we have refixation circuits. We have covert and overt when we are looking to the impulses to the left lateral. But of course, we have some strange or funny things on the right lateral. And this is the spontaneous nystagmus as shown there that shall be during the testing. Which is the amount of asymmetry do we consider in the case of the laterals? Well, this is important and this is not important. Do as you want, because this is the asymmetry comes from the history of the caloric test when we were just working with non-absolute numbers, just relative numbers, and we have to make a correlation from one to the other side. So we needed a percentage of damage because we didn't know which was the absolute number. Here we have absolute numbers. We have six numbers. Each of them is going to give us information of one canal. So what for do we need an asymmetry ratio? I mean, this is an open question, but of course it should be more or less a 20% difference between one side and the other will be pathologic for the lower side. But I mean, this is quite confusing, but this is a recent paper. I would suggest if you want to work some time with asymmetry, do that way. How a patient behaves in the follow-up of a unilateral vestibulopathy? Well, most of them do well, do recover, but many times saccades are going to change, but gain will never. Will be modified a little bit. And this is a nice paper, also not also recent, in which there was no correlation between the ipsilateral high velocity VOR and the follow-up when you match the situation of the patient with tests of handicap and the severity of vestibular symptoms score. So in this way, we can say, well, gain doesn't seem to be the best way for following this patient. And of course, I agree. If you have a patient with a vestibular neuritis in acute stage with a gain in the horizontal canal, say 0.3, 6 years later, he shall be probably on 0.3, 0.4, not more than that, but probably the patient is feeling well. Where do we have to look? We don't have to look to the gain. Of course, we have to, but in order to follow, to track compensation, I would recommend you to look for the saccade. This is a nice cartoon made by one of my co-workers, Dr. Jorge Rey in San Sebastian, in which we try to show what happens to the saccades. You know, this is the two different patients. On your left side, we have a patient, and we show only the eye velocity curve. This is a cartoon. And we have a low response. We place the head velocity just in the right side of each of the cartoons, and you see how the eye velocity doesn't get to be as same as the head velocity. I think you can see my cursor. And then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 impulses, each after the other, saccades, refixation saccade are going to appear almost at the same time. We can say this is an isochronic response. When we plot all the responses, all the impulses in one figure, as usually the system does, we can see how the low gain gets almost always the same, and saccades are all together here. On the right side, you can see another different plate, another patient also with a very small response, but saccades do appear whenever they want. Sometimes they are two after one impulse. In other cases, one very early, very late, in the middle. So when you plot them, you see in the 2D plot that they appear at several periods of time. We should say heterochronic. So the time is different. The timing is very different for each of them. We also decided to call them also organized in the first case, disorganized in the second case, or gather and scatter. This is the way to see these things. And I think we did realize this by looking to these plots. And this was a very nice, the seminal paper came from Dr. Batuecas in Salamanca, doing his work on patients after a vestibular neurectomy. And just looking to the 3D plots, we saw that saccades anyway are always at the same time. In this case, we have a low gain, then we have a first cover saccade, and then a second over saccade. But if you see covert, they are all come together. Over, they come all at the same time. The plot goes from impulses with low to higher velocity. These are not plots made one after the other. They are put that way. So that if you see gain is always low, eye velocity on green is always lower than head velocity on red, but saccades, that are those peaks that appear on the right side, they appear organized always at the same time. This is another patient, also low gain of the VOR, I'm sorry, low gain of the VOR, but if you see the saccades are gonna appear anytime, different impulses at different periods of time. This is another interesting patient, also very low gain, it's a left side unilateral vestibulopathy, and we have very low, almost covered but over saccades, and then we have high over saccades. Be careful on this, because sometimes this is an artifact, it's a fast eye movement, and it's not a really real thing, it's an artifact. And this is another case. Also, you can see this another right low gain response with not organized saccades. So we try to model these things, and we are doing that way, and just doing some basic research ongoing now there in Pamplona. And we thought to before modeling to give an index for this, and we call the PR index in a case with a normal response, a normal head video head impulse test. We don't see saccades, so we have a zero score. Then we have a isochronic or gather saccades, and we have then the scatter saccades. And for each of them, we were able to put some cutoff amount of a score. So in some way, what we want to do is, of course, is just to put a number and just to say, okay, this patient was like in this case, when he or she came, is a very early onset response, gain is 0.12, the PR score is 71, you see saccades appear at any time, then follow up, saccades began to organize, and then at the end, gain is 0.27, but as you see, the score of the PR, that means how the saccades are organized, has changed a lot. The shape is quite different. So in some way, we are thinking that this is a very good way for a correlation to compensation. And this is the paper I would suggest you to look at laryngoscope. There were patients surgically treated, all were the same surgery, same result, same caloric test, that's complete reflexia, same almost gain of the VOR, some of them, those on the left upper part of the slide, with very well organized saccades, some others with disorganized saccades, and the correlation to the DHI, you see those with organized saccades were very low DHI score, those with a scatter saccades had a higher DHI score. So we think this is a good way to analyze compensation. We have another one. We have a new strategy to study the bigger inputs that are called the SHIMP, the SHIMP paradigm. We have this case. This is a patient with a right side vestibular neuritis the second day. I'm sorry. And then this is the paradigm. In this case, we perform the head impulse test, but what the patient has to look to is a red sign that is moving, a laser that is moving with the head. So when the head is moved to the left, the laser dot is to the left. That is where the patient has to look. But just when once this is finished, the VOR took the eye to the right side, to the contrary direction. So the patient has to make a big sake just to see there almost more than 400 degrees per second. So this is a normal response. What do we see in the case of the patient with vestibular neuritis? The patient with the, you see there in the upper part, a low gain, a lot of saccades, scatter, not organized, high PR, chronic, the patient do feels very bad. What do we see with the SHIM test? We ask the patient to move the head to the right, the dot is to the right, and as there's no VOR, the eye is also to the right. So at this point, the patient doesn't perform no saccades. So on the HIM test, saccades are not good. On the SHIM test, saccades are good. It should be a kind of fast thing to remember. And of course, we do see that there's a nice correlation still on study about the appearance of saccades on SHIM testing and compensation. That is probably the mirror image of our organization of the saccades. So as a summary, in patients with vertigo, any one of them, the video hidden pulse is gonna be able to give us a first look at the vestibular deficit and compensation. Anyone there can ask, okay, calorics can do the same almost. We could discuss about this. Okay, but I think it's much more convenient to perform a video hidden pulse. It's not a problem of specificity of sensitivity. It's not a problem of a statistic. It's a problem of convenience. I think that getting this information through a video hidden pulse test is much more convenient for all of us than with a caloric test. Also, this test has a localizing value. We are able, sorry, the slide is in Spanish. We have the ability to test the canals with the head impulse, but of course, do not forget that we have the vestibular evoked myogenic potential, the O and C vamp, O vamp flying through the superior part of the vestibular nerve, C vamp go through the lower parts, through a lower subdivision of the vestibular nerve. So we need to implement in our world of VEM testing to localize much better all the disorders and the deficits. As I said before, now we are able to have the vestibular ocular test with the video head impulse test, the angular VOR, and of course the linear VOR with the OVEM, and then we have the vestibular spinal reflex with the CVEM. Those are reflexes. How we use them on daily life must be connected to dynamic visual acuity and dynamic posturography, how much our acuity, visual acuity, falls when you move the head. And this helped me to go to the next step, that is chronic dizziness, a patient with a chronic dizziness. And then we have two main questions. The first one, is there any vestibulopathy behind this, or there was any vestibulopathy behind it, or is there any gait and posture disorder? This is a kind of roadmap also that I use for the differential diagnosis of this patient, because chronic dizziness can be due to many disorders, or at least all of those you see here. And at this point, probably most interesting, the most relevant part is going to say, do we have a vestibulopathy, yes or no? We have the video head impulse test. And then, if we have a bilateral vestibulopathy, what do we do then? Well, the approach in this case for me is, as I show here, the video head impulse test is giving me diagnosis, severity, it's gonna give even a pattern of findings. It's not the same that you have the verticals and neither the horizontals or vice versa damage, and then you are able to do the follow-up. Then you have the SHIM test that's going to help you in the follow-up, but also to a better measure of the gain. And then we have a very interesting test, a very interesting paradigm, that is the visual vestibular interaction, that is called in the test as the VOR test. This is a patient with a tremendous bilateral vestibulopathy. You see 0.07 in the left, 0.18 in the right horizontal canal. There's no reflex, nothing. This is another type, and those both of them are bilateral vestibulopathy. So we can get some kind of some view about the severity of the disorder. Probably this one is less than the other, and of course it's less than the other. Sometimes we have just five canals, and then we have, for some reason, the left anterior. This is typical for Meniere's disease, bilateral Meniere's disease. We can have another way. We have no response, very low, very low gains of the VOR with all different types of saccades. So there's a way to know about the amount of damage, and of course we have to define patterns of damage. This is the Schimpf test in a patient with a bilateral vestibulopathy. In the left lateral, there's no saccade. That is not good. But as you see on the right Schimpf, there are some saccades. Well, that is pretty good. So the pattern, I mean, we everything is not said on bilateral vestibulopathy still. There's a room for research there that I would suggest to any of you. What do we do next in these patients? We will go for the visual vestibular interaction test, in which we want to zoom or add a smooth pursuit, optokinetic nystagmus to vestibular ocular reflex. And this gives the most interesting portion of this test. This is how we perform the visual vestibular interaction. Well, I'm going to show you. Oops. Oh my God. Thought this was gonna run. Well, we are going to see in the upper part. I'm moving the head one side to the other. I just look to the round, to the lower part to the left. There you see Dr. Beckman doing their work. And in the upper part is slower, but I would suggest this is the way to do it, a little bit fast. And this is the response. We have in a normal case, we have an eye velocity superimposed on the head velocity, eye velocity on green, head velocity on orange, and this is a normal response. I would suggest you to study, because this is a paper to study, it's not a paper to read, on the some method we have just implemented. It's not on the system, it's on the web, it's free for any one of you. It's a way to analyze the visual vestibular interaction. So as I said before, this is a patient with a bilateral vestibulopathy. Just have a look at the gains of the VOR. This is a patient that got gentamicin because of a serious illness. And of course, the only problem is that gentamicin went to the inner ears and then destroyed the whole thing. But all the neurological framework of his eye movements was doing well. So he's going to be able, when moving the head, just focusing to one point in front, to introduce smooth pursuit in the paradigm, just to get a good visual acuity. And then we have this another patient. It's a patient, same problem, unsteady in darkness, a lot of oscillopsia, just low VR gains, you're seeing here. And then as the patient has a central disorder that is a kind of ataxia of the vestibular, of the ocular, and of the proprioception, I mean, there's not a smooth pursuit. The visual vestibular interaction is interrupted by all these saccades. So if you see a patient with a bilateral vestibulopathy, perform the Schimpf test and then go to the VOR. That's gonna help you a lot. Of course, you must have done before the smooth pursuit, but the way to acknowledge how both systems work are gonna be seen in this test. That is gonna help you a lot on the differential diagnosis of patients with central versus peripheral disorders. So faster diagnosis. We don't see much more bilateral vestibulopathy than before, but we go faster. Precise evaluation. Of course, we don't see much more patients than before. We are not missing anymore. Severity, of course, we need to correlate this to the amount of oscillopsia or ataxia the patient has. Pattern recognition, this is gonna change what I said in the second point. Probably now we can be a little bit much more precise, just looking at a patient that probably horizontals are doing well, but verticals not. So in the caloric test, time or in the rotary chair test time, this patient was a patient with a normal calorics, lot of oscillopsia, lot of unsteadiness, but normal calorics. Now we know that the problem was not in the horizontals, it's in the vertical. So probably some things are gonna change. Differential diagnosis, central versus peripheral, simple, very simple. And of course the follow-up of the patient. So just to summarize my talk, just waiting for questions, a patient with a chronic disequilibrium, of course, we need to know if there's a vestibulopathy recent or an all uncompensated. We can localize the deficit, side number of receptors, nerve subdivision. And of course, in the case of bilateral vestibulopathy, we are gonna have a very fast disclosure of the disorder. So, sorry to be so fast. I hope you understood my ugly English. And of course, ready for questions. Magdalena, waiting for you now.
Okay, I'm looking at questions right now. The first question that we've been asked, actually, before I do that, let me kind of put this up so that you can see it as well. In case you have any questions afterward, you can always send it to us. But we will be posting a copy of this presentation onto our website so that you can download it and watch it again later. So for the person who asked that, you'll be able to review it again in the future. But what other questions might we have today? All right, we have a question here. Dr. Perez, do you have any experience in patients with cerebellar ataxia? Is the question that's been posed.
Okay, these patients, yes, of course, all the scars and things like that. So I would say that in these patients, we are going to have a very particular combination of findings. Of course, most of them are going to be very much to show a very much distorted ocular motility, you know, gaze evolved down with nystagmus. It can also occur with a rotary nystagmus. I mean, it's going to be a very abnormal finding. Some of them will have a bilateral vestibulopathy, and some of them the main disorder is going to have a bilateral vestibulopathy. So in those cases, the type of gain amount, the gain reduction of and of saccades are going to be quite differential, because in sometimes you can have a patient with a bilateral vestibulopathy with no saccades or very abnormal saccades. So in these patients, as we know much more of them, we see that in those with a bilateral vestibulopathy, you're going to have an abnormal saccades response. In those who are not getting the bilateral vestibulopathy, what you're going to get is an abnormal eye motility. And those cases, probably sometimes vestibular still works for a small period of time, but those are a very particular group of patients.
Okay, do you have time for just a couple more, Dr. Perez? One question is that do you work closely with physical therapy?
Not that much. I would like to work much more than before, and we are looking for a close participation, because when we began to work with all this issue of the saccades, we thought, can we train to make saccades to become covert? So we did say, this is published, and I think it's a new way to work with. So at this point, it's a new avenue to work with the physiotherapists, because they probably are going to understand much better how to help these patients to get a good VOR, or at least to put saccades on a much more interesting, covert way.
Okay, and then just one more question here, and then the rest we'll collect and email afterward. But the question was, explain SHIMP relative to peripheral loss determining residual function versus central abnormality. Are you also assessing VOR cancellation?
Well, the VOR cancellation can go through two ways. One is just with the visual, and the other is with saccades. So in the SHIMP test, we have seen some cancellation of the VOR. So in a patient with a peripheral vestibulopathy, the amount of vestibulopathy is going to influence the gain much better. So you are going to see a very low gain in those patients. When you perform the SHIM, you're going to get a little bit much more a lower gain than in the HIM test. The saccades are going to be the most important issue. So as I said before, saccades are meaning a recovery, or at least are a normal thing. And if you did not see them, then you are seeing some recovery. However, the actual experience with SHIM tests and central pacing is very low. And of course, it's not very much disseminated, the test, unfortunately. And I think that's another way for research in those patients. Of what I have done on patients with a bilateral vestibulopathy, in case of my CANVAS patients, of course, we don't see no saccade on them because they suffer bilateral vestibulopathy. The other question is there any abnormal functioning of the in the brainstem that does not help, allows you to perform saccade? So at that point, you are having a much more, a bigger problem since the very beginning. But I think I would say this is an important way for research.
Okay. Well, thank you very much again, Dr. Perez, and thank you so much to everyone for your time this morning.
Okay, thank you very much.
If you have any further questions, you can send them to my email, but we're going to go ahead and end the webinar now. Thank you all again.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.